Morning. Oh, yes, we're on it today. I'm glad to see everybody. I'm glad to see all of our VBS helpers have survived the week. It was a really, really great week. But y'all, it was a long week, a little bit. I'm seeing them rolling, like shaking their heads. We had 24 kids come for VBS, and the best part is a lot of them we had never met before. Some of them are new to the area, we think. We were trying to figure that out. Some of them had heard about our church she wasn't sure who, but she does think it was Miss Shirley. Some of them, we send out little flyers and cards from schools, and they had a great time. And we heard all week, thank you so much for doing this. Our kids loved it. Okay, that last little phrase there, our kids have loved this week. And even better is the parents were coming in and telling us that their kids were going home and telling them everything that they had learned. They were telling, yeah, Bella, there's a video proof of this online of Bella Janey telling her daddy all about VBS that night. And that's what all of the kids were doing. And so we're going to actually, in just a couple minutes, not right now, I'm going to show off our kids. They're going to come and say one of their verses for you. But I wanted to take a minute, and I wanted to say thank you. From the planning stages, people helped us putting ideas together, to your donations, your watermelon or your grapes or your cases of water turned into lessons. When Jessica and her kitchen team turned our snacks into, like, pictures, like, they made walking on water, and they made boats, and they made all kinds of crazy things out of the basic things that we brought. And the kids not only got to eat and enjoy it, but they could understand the story in another way. So thank you for everything that you donated. Thank you for your prayers. And thank you for everybody who pitched in. We had a lot of help decorating. We had a lot of help just on the nights. It was amazing. So y'all, can you just like give them a round of applause? Say thank you. Before we go into announcements, I am going to go ahead and invite our offering stewards down. We did recently make this change just so we can do offering while we're doing announcements, so you don't think I'm all out of order. But as we pray for our service this morning and as we pray for our world, it got a little bit crazier yesterday. Everybody here knows exactly what I'm talking about. It is a crazy year. It is an election year, but we need to pray for our nation because there's no place for violence, for anything, for the people who lost their lives. We want to pray for those families. We want to pray over our nation. We want to pray for unity and for peace. And tomorrow, Terrell, I don't know if you've heard, Terrell is going to be having a pacemaker put in. So we're going to take a minute and we're going to pray over him. So I just ask that whenever we do pray over him, just extend your hand out. We're not going to gather because he's going to be having surgery. We don't want to pass on any germs we may have, but extend your hand and just show support that we're praying over him. And, let him know as we're leaving service today that we will be praying for him and upholding him. So let's go before God and let's just pour our hearts out. Father, I thank you for this morning that we can gather in this place. Father, I thank you for this beautiful reminder of your abundance down here on the communion table, Lord, these things from our garden that you have made, the ways that you are providing for our people and for this community, Father. We give you thanks. Lord, I thank you for every person who is here, for every person who has joined us this morning. Father, I thank you for those who are watching online. I thank you for those children and those families that joined us this week at VBS. Father, we just give you glory for what you are doing because it is you moving. It is you in this place, and we give you all the praise and all the glory. Father, we just pray that as we worship you this morning, that you would turn our hearts to what you are doing, that you would open our ears, that you would open our eyes, that you would continue to pour out your blessing on our children's and our youth ministries, that they may continue to see you and learn about you, not just in stories, but through people who love you, seeing your word in action in this place. Father, I thank you for how they are already learning and for what you are already doing. Father, we just pray over our country. Lord, we are broken. There is so much that needs a touch from you. There is hatred and there is bitterness and there is brokenness and there is hopelessness. Father, we could list all the things that are going on in our nation that need your touch, but Father, you know them. And we, Lord, we just ask for a move of your Holy Spirit. Father, I pray that you would move and that you would bring unity where there is division, that you would help us as a whole to turn to you. Lord, the only thing that's going to fix our problems is when we submit ourselves to you. And I pray, Lord, that you would put your hand of protection upon our leaders and give them wisdom and give them guidance. Lord, we know you are the only one who can change the course that we are on, and we just pray in the name of Jesus that you would so move. Lord, start with us. May we submit ourselves to you and do your will. And Lord, I pray that there would just be a revival where this would be something that you do all over the nation through your people, and that it would overflow into the world around us. Use us. Lord, we just pray that you would heal us where we are broken. Lord, we pray over the families that are grieving and mourning this week. Lord, we know there are many hurts and many situations that we need to bring before you, Father. And we just bring them as they go through our minds, Lord. And right now, we specifically stop and we lift up our brother, Terrell, to you. Lord, I give you glory that the issue that he's been going through has been caught, that they were able to notice that something was going on with his heart, and they were able to be in at the doctors and get this looked at. Lord, we give you glory for how speedy that was. We thank you. And Father, as he goes for this procedure tomorrow, we pray in the mighty name of Jesus that it would go well, that it would go smoothly, and that he would feel better, that his body would just be refreshed and renewed. And instead of going through pain and recovery, Lord, that you would just wake him up feeling great. And I pray that he would just be able to be right back up, back to himself, not be knocked down by this at all. Father, we pray for wisdom, we pray for guidance, and we just pray that you would guide the doctors and the nurses. Lord, be with him every step of the way. We know you're there, but remind him, surround him, lift him and Charlotte and the rest of the family up. Lord, we give you all the glory for what you are already doing, and we thank you in advance for how you have heard our prayers and how you will move. As we give to you this morning, we pray your blessings upon it, and may this service glorify you in every way. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. It's almost time. It's almost time. I'm going to invite you up in just a minute. They're ready. There's a couple things I want to point out in your bulletin. Family camp is this week. I don't know if y'all have experienced Legacy Family Camp. Many of you have. If you have not, this would be a fantastic time to do it. You just head on down to Table Rock Camp and Retreat Center, where we have our district camps. And this week, it is going to be focused on families. There's something for kids going on. There's an extra VBS. There are messages at 7 p.m. during the week, and they are excellent. There's a time of worship. On Friday, I believe, is the prayer service. Saturday is when we get to celebrate our Hispanic brothers and sisters, and they make us the best food in the whole world. It's just a time of fellowship and being together and worshiping. So there are more details about that. There's a poster on the office door. You can ask Matt and I. I'm sure it's on the websites. So if you have any questions, just catch up with us about that. There's a churchyard sale coming up on August 10th. Got that right? Okay, cool. If you have things to bring, talk to Miss Shirley. She is that mastermind. She will tell you exactly what to do and where to put things and how much tables are. And I'm really excited about this one. There is a bridal shower, a wedding shower coming up. We're going to celebrate Cynthia and Freddie. You'll see this coming up. They've invited the whole church. Their wedding will actually be on August 17th. That's the next weekend. And they want everyone to come. And before we come and celebrate their wedding, we want to take just a second and just celebrate what God has done in their lives. We're going to be having the wedding shower downstairs. Everybody's welcome. We're going to just have a good time fellowshipping and just celebrating. So if you got questions about that, if you love decorating, come and see me. I'd be happy to help you. Now it's time for our kids to come up. Instead of reading scripture to you with you today, we decided that it would be pretty cool for our kids to come off and show off this verse that they memorized. You can come up. There's plenty of room. Yeah, go ahead, B. You can stand up there. Come on, Stephen.
I'll stand up with you.
Excellent. Good choice.
I want Clinton to.
You want Clinton to stand up there? He can stand up there. All right, they worked really hard. Now, some of our big kids did learn some extra verses, but all of our kids learned this verse this week. Are you ready?
Say it really loud in the microphone.
Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Psalms 25:4.
Give them a round of applause. Great job, guys. You can have a seat. All right, we're going to hand it over to our worship team.
Good morning, everybody. Let's stand and worship. It's a rough act to follow. They did good.
Me levanto y me cambió. Yo en tierra firme estoy. Gracias a Padre, gracias a Cristo.
when we recognize something that is so clearly God, it is good to share it. And so we went to Charleston this week to visit a college, and we knew a couple of our tires were bad, and James like, you can't go unless you get the tires changed, right? So we looked at the tires, we got the front two tires changed. I was like, the back don't look that bad. We drove all the way to and from Charleston, got home, and when I got home the next day or so, the back tire was completely flat. We looked at it. There, it was bad. Like several spots, there was like
steel,
and then there was another layer of rubber worn away, and then more steel was showing. So like that didn't happen overnight. We very well should have been on the side of the road, stranded somewhere between here and Charleston, but we weren't. And I just praise God for that. You know, and praising God and recognizing what He does is important because it helps us see that we are cared for by our Father. Scripture says that every good and perfect gift is from God who loves us. What a blessing to be His child.
I'm a child of God. On my worst day, I'm a child of God. Oh, every day is a good day. You're the reason why I'm so blessed. I'm so blessed. Got this heartbeat in my chest. Doesn't matter about the rest. I got you, Lord. I'm so blessed. I'm so blessed. I'm so blessed. Got this heartbeat in my chest. Doesn't
grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things, at all times, you may abide in every good work.
Father, to the Father, defender of the weak, freedom for the prisoner we see.
you this morning. I thank you that hearts are here, ready and willing to praise you with our voices. God, focus our minds on you as we hear your word. Transform our hearts and our minds today, God, as we stand in your presence. In Jesus' name, children can be dismissed.
Pastor Kim forgot one thing during the announcements, which is really funny. And the only reason I think it's really funny, for pretty much all of VBS, she was running the whole show. My whole part of it was running games and making sure come Sunday, some of VBS flowed in so you guys could help celebrate it. And pretty much everything that she didn't want to do was anything that flew into Sunday. So figure that one out. But she forgot. We set it up with the kids that if they did certain things like memory verse, show up, bring other people, we would put their name on a ticket, put it in this, and they would get to win a session at Retro Game Lounge. And for those of you who are like, what is that? It's this funky little place in the Anderson Mall. It's like one of four places that's actually still open in the Anderson Mall, because that place is depressing. But it's true. Go to any small mall in America. It's just depressing now. But it has like every retro video game system, a whole bunch of the towers, arcade cabinets. It has the new stuff. It is fun if you are a kid. It is fun if you were an 80s, 90s kid like me who misses arcades actually existing. And then anybody older, you're probably like, I'll drop you off. I'm going to get a coffee somewhere else. So I'm going to ask James to come up because he has no horse in this race, and I still have at least one horse in it. So you get to draw two names. And hopefully they're not the same one because that'd be awkward. Yep. All right. Bella, you win first, which makes it easy for me. Oh, wait, no. I thought it said Clint for a second. And Claire's the other one who's obviously not here, but some of our VBS kids came to us for VBS, and on Sunday morning, they're at a different church, and Claire is at Bethel. Yeah, all the ones that did not have a church home were like, yeah, you go to your church home. We're going to email you if you win. You came and did the work, though. So that's the other one that won. So that's done it, other than me emailing it. And kids, now you can run and go. So for those that you guys forgot, we are in a series called The Meltdown. We're doing this in part because we recognize that during the summer, it is going to get so hot that despite, you know, everybody living here forever and knowing there's at least one week where South Carolina removes itself from the earth and places it where mercury goes, we still can't stand it. And this summer, I think we're on, what, week four of it being a heat wave? And when we planned this series, we were like, oh, we're going to talk about all these situations in the Old Testament, because we only had enough weeks to do the Old Testament ones, that the people just had these emotional breakdowns, and there are things we can identify with and learn from Scripture how to move forward or do better, because some of them, they did move forward. Some of them are just more examples of just don't do what they did. And as soon as we started talking about this, I was like, we have to do Elisha and the bear. And as soon as I said that, Kim's like, no, we don't. Because she's like, how are you going to preach anything on a prophet of God sending bears after children? And I was like, I don't know, but that's clearly a meltdown. And I've been looking forward to this one so much because I've read it in Scripture a bunch, but I've never had a reason to study it. And I'm like, I can't wait to study this to figure out what is actually going on here. And even before I'm reading the Scripture, because just how this works, you're getting your first point. It's not a meltdown. This was so comical to dive into this Scripture, read the commentaries, get the information about it, and realize this is not a meltdown. We're in the middle of a series about meltdowns. We've already broadcast. We're doing Elisha this week. We're talking about it. I was like, it's not a meltdown. And it was definitely weird going from the commentaries and the scripture and understanding this more, and then seeking God in prayer and him still going, no, you still need to preach on this, because there's a reality of there's sometimes it's not about you with the meltdown. That sometimes you're acting appropriately and everybody else sees you and goes, what is wrong with them? So this week, it's not a what scripture's saying in a situation and what you should do in that type of a meltdown. It's more we're looking at scripture and seeking God and what to do when everybody else thinks you're having a meltdown. So let's jump into the scripture here. It's 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 23 through 25. And it says, from there Elisha went up to Bethel. And as he was walking along the road, some boys come out of the town and jeered at him. Get out of here, Baldy, they said. Get out of here, Baldy. He turned around, looked at them, and called down a curse on them in the name of the Lord. Then two bears came out of the woods and mauled 42 of the boys. And he went on to Mount Carmel from there and returned to Samaria. So, yeah, let's pray. This one's going to be so much fun. God, I just pray that it's just completely and utterly illuminated why you left this in here for us to read and learn from and just to grow closer to you. Jesus, we pray this all in your blessed name. Amen. So, I don't know if any of you guys have ever read a commentary on Scripture, but usually they tend to be very dry reading. It's a lot of historical facts. It's a lot of language facts. Trying to condense in the best way possible for you to understand, honestly, thousands upon thousands of years of history that you are removed from. I think Jesus alone, we are removed 2,000 years from that. Culture has changed a lot since then. But to go to Elijah, we're going back even another about 2,000 years, if not a little bit more. So that's a lot of change. Like, truth be told, if I brought up something from you guys from like the early 1900s, we're already starting to have trouble relating to that, and it wasn't even that long ago. Like, it amazes me when people will say to me things around the idea that, why isn't racism just done? Didn't we finish that back hundreds of years ago? Now, keep in mind, the ones that usually say hundreds of years ago are like the students I teach, whose perspective on time is just wildly messed up. Then I have to point out, it's really the last big marker for that was the 1960s. And they can't fathom in their mind that the 1960s was only about 60 years ago. My math is still right on that, right? I have some people saying yes, some people saying no, so I'm not really worried which one it is. Yeah. So, it just doesn't compute to them. So now think about how much culture has changed when you put 4,000 years. And I know some people say our culture is more rapidly changed because of some technology things that we've had in recent history, but it's still changed. And so commentaries try and help us move ourselves back to that original time, and they're usually really dry. This is easily the funniest commentaries, though, I've ever read. Because we start with them talking about Elisha being bald. And it says, it's either one of two realities, and it's so far back in time, and there's so few notes about this, because this is the only time it's actually mentioned that Elisha is bald, that it's one of two things. And the good thing they put, it was either he was doing something like monks do, where they shave their heads, and it was a thing of holiness, and they compare it to something like a Nazirite vow. If you don't remember that, Samson had the Nazirite vow, where he had to always grow his hair, he could never cut it, which is actually really weird, because a Nazirite vow is you cut it once a year when you make a sacrifice at the temple. It was super weird for Samson to never cut. Or, and this legitimately says this in a commentary, he was either doing this holy thing or he was super ugly. Not Elijah was prematurely balding, not maybe he just didn't have hair, that it was his style. Their options are it was either a holy thing or the man was super ugly. I don't know. I found that funny because you only have less than a year before, maybe 2 years before, Elijah is walking by Elisha's farm and he's more or less described as a strapping young man. Now, either they had the hardest ministry ever for him to go from strapping young to super ugly, or yeah, it probably was a religious thing that he was doing it. So that was one of the parts that this was really funny. The other part, and it says this in multiple commentaries, it says that the scripture is very clear that the word used on the bear attack is that they were mauled. So don't be reading that all 42 kids died. That tells me two things here. Either these commentators are really hopeful or they've never been around a bear attack. You don't have a bear mauling 42 people and go, oh, they're probably all just in the hospital. I'm not trying to be glib here. It was a bear attack. They got mauled. The majority of them are probably dead. Now, for those of you who are still held up, I was like, wait, why is the pastor talking about somebody sending bears to attack children? This is the other part that we have to go over here. If you're reading children in this and thinking, you know, somebody younger than a teenager, you're a little bit off in your years. These are probably 20-somethings to even up to early 30s. Because the way the Jewish system was set up, you had your whole bar mitzvah age, so you're technically a man now if you go through that system, that's your rite of passage. But then your next marker is sometime in your early 30s, you should be moving from apprenticeship to being a master of something. This is when your parent would turn over the business to you, or if you were in a religious sect, so like the Sadducees, Pharisees, rabbis and stuff, that is when you would start moving from being an apprentice to a teacher. This is why Jesus' ministry didn't start till he was 30. He was following in that system. So when it says children, you're looking much older. You're looking at an age where you should know better. Even in the jokes and somewhat apt things that we say about young adults and teens today, where we say there's a delayed level of adulthood now, even them in the mid-20s to early 30s, we would go, you know better than to make fun of somebody for being bald, especially over religious reasons. So don't be reading it of, okay, this is one of the most horrific stories in Scripture ever, that a prophet went and sent bears after eight-year-olds. Think a little more. This is one of the most horrific stories in Scripture ever, that a prophet sent bears after 20-year-olds. It makes it slightly better. But this is one of those things, under a flat reading, no matter how we condition things, it still doesn't quite seem right. And then one more little secret came up. Because for us, the scripture was written just as Elisha went up to Bethel. It is reading to us like a map. It's just listing a location. It would help us for all of history if it was read that Elisha went up to Bethel, the most sinful place in all of Israel. Because when you look at the history and what was going on in Bethel at the time, it was the worst of the worst. It'd be like us sending a message to like the furthest parts of South America where, you know, internet and most books have not reached there, and saying, hey, this one pastor got in trouble because he went to Las Vegas. And they'd be like, wait, why? What's wrong with Las Vegas? The rest of us would get that concept. Our imagination would run wild. A pastor in trouble in Las Vegas, there is definitely some options there. But the rest of them is like, it's a place. Why does he get in trouble? When we read this, we read it, he goes to Bethel. Okay, what's the big deal? It's a big deal. It is the most sinful place in Israel. It is the place where the idols are running rampant and everybody is disrespecting God. It is so easy for us to look in Scripture and go, oh, it's just another place in Israel. Israel is God's chosen people. It must be a good place. And forget that it literally, in almost every story of Israel, the chapter before is how horrible they are as a people and how much they've turned away from God. Pastor Kim talked about a few weeks ago, or last week, and this is only a few chapters beforehand, that Elijah, the person who trained Elisha, had to go against every prophet of Baal. Because that was normal. Not the going against them. It was normal that everybody in Israel was not worshiping God. And that only happened probably a few months before this. And yeah, all the prophets are now taken care of. But you think all of culture changed? That every single person in every single city in Israel just magically turned back to God. I could believe everybody around Mount Carmel did, because that's where the event took place. But unless everybody actually went out and prophesied and turned the hearts back to God, it probably didn't. We know from that account to this account, we had Elijah, we had Elisha, and there's about 50 other prophets with servants. That may have been all of who was spreading the word of God. And pretty much every time they're talked about, they're all together. So it wasn't like they spread across the country to go, hey, the prophets of Baal have been defeated. The wicked queen has been defeated. We should all turn back to God without any fear. Now they were all huddled together, going and performing miracle from miracle in cities and not turning cities back to God, but turning households back to God. So while this is not a meltdown, this is not Elijah acting out of anger and frustration, it is Elijah acting out of a passion for God. This is him going, you are mocking me because of something I have done to follow God because you do not believe. And we usually read it as Elisha then sent the bears after them. But what it actually says is then Elijah calls down a curse on them in the name of the Lord. It is not written, it is never said, what is that curse? He just says he curses them in the name of the Lord. God's the one that chose bears. And it's one of the hard things for us to wrestle with when these Old Testament incidents happen, and then we get to Jesus in the New Testament and how he's all about patience and love. And we have these instances like, wait, what's going on here? And anytime you have those situations, I really think one of the best parts of how you should use that Jesus lens to view this is go, okay, Jesus flipped over the tables and beat people with a whip in a temple. The temple was supposed to be full of people that knew exactly how to worship God, and they weren't. They turned a house of prayer to a den of thieves. Bethel was one of the top cities, very much associated with David. It should have been one of the places protected in its worship of God, but every citizen in it, according to this, was the worst, and absolute sinners. So take Jesus going just at the temple, put him in that situation, he's still probably having a moment of violence. And it's weird to go for this, because we like Jesus meek and mild. We like Jesus taking the sacrifice for us. We don't tend to think of Jesus does discipline. And we have a lot of trouble with Jesus sending bears to maul people. It's not normal. And it's not like it happened every single time. This is one of the reasons I was thinking this week. I wish we were going all into the New Testament and doing some of those moments of meltdown, especially Jesus, because we have Jesus in the temple and we have Jesus with the fig tree. And both of those seem completely out of character. And the only reason they seem out of character is because we like limiting the character of Jesus to where it's palatable. It's part of the reason why we have a church discipline issue now, because we all want to be meek and mild and represent Jesus, but then somebody does something horrible, and they're like, well, what if we give them more time and give them a hug, and maybe we give them a juice box, and maybe then they'll like stop doing the evil things and forget. Jesus cleared out the temple, and Paul's like, tell them to knock it off. They're ruining your church. They're ruining the bride of Christ. They are staining and blemishing the bride of Christ because you think we need to be nice and we can't say anything offensive. Paul's like, turn them over to their sins, kick them out so that they know in desperation that they need Jesus. I'm pretty sure these 42 boys, young men, as a bear is mauling them, are having some choice words and crying out to God and realizing in their desperation they need God. Partially because I've known a few people that had a bear attack. And the ones that lived all said they cried out to God in that moment. I know some of us like to make jokes about the whole, you know, there's no atheist in a foxhole moments and stuff. It's not a joke, it's true. In desperation, you cry out to God. The reason we joke about it is because a lot of people get out of the desperation and they're not still crying out to God. So yeah, this may be offensive to our sensibilities that God sent some bears after them. But what should not be offensive to our sensibilities is knowing that when we need to act in discipline to people that should know God, that should know Jesus, that should know better, that it isn't the person melting down, that they are acting in accordance with Scripture and the character of Christ. That when you are being made so much so in Christ's likeness, that you are also being made in the likeness of God, which is absolute holiness, and there will be a level of disgust that you will have to those that choose not to be, that should know better. And to make this clear, this is those that should know better, not those that don't know better. And sometimes when we talk about this stuff, people get those wires crossed. They're like, yeah, I need to go protest the next, you know, fill in the blank here. No, those are people far from God that don't know God. Those you love, you bring them closer to God. Sorry, getting dry mouthed here. We're talking about those who have been in church, always in church, know Scripture well on some level, that should know better. This is the type of scenarios here. Literally every teen in our youth group has triggered one of these scenarios now, where they'll say something along the lines, well, we should just kill this person. Or, well, they did this, so I need to do that. They know if they say anything like this, whatever my lesson is, it's out the window. It might come back, but that's out the window. They know better. They grew up in this church. They grew up in churches. They grew up with the fact that the first thing that we teach any of them is pretty much John 3:16, and Jesus loves little children, all the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white. They are precious in his sight. Which I really feel like they should add a second and third verse there. Like an American centralized verse where Republican, Democrat, Libertarian, they're still precious in his sight. Or if they're stupid, Jesus still loves them. I'm not really sure how you would tune that one in, because everybody loves making some exception that Jesus somehow doesn't love them. Nope. Everybody is loved. not everybody is agreed with, because for some reason people hear me say, Jesus loves Democrats. He's like, I can't believe you said Jesus agrees with blah, 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 blah. I was like, no. And it's true on the other side too. If you've been a parent of humans or animals, you love them unconditionally. But you don't agree with them, with everything they do. If my dog decides something inside the bathroom, I'm not agreeing with that. I still love him. He's getting kicked outside for a little bit, but we're not agreeing with it. If we are being made into the holiness of God, in the likeness of Christ, we are going to love everyone, but those who know better, we should be disgusted when they start rambling about something that does not equal Christ. And we should be willing to offend those. And we should be able to bear the heartache of Christ. I don't think I've ever heard that term before, but we should be able to bear the heartache of Christ of letting them go sometimes. I really wish we had some of the letters of Paul still that followed up from the Corinthians, like a third or fourth or fifth Corinthians, because I fully believe that if the Corinthian church did follow that instruction that was given of kick that one person out, turn them over to their sins, there is a later letter where they celebrate that person coming back. Because it's not you kick them out and then you have nothing to do with them. It's now you're loving them from a different position. You understand now that they are far from Christ and you're doing everything to bring them back. But when those moments happen, not everyone will know what is really going on. Unless it is the most public display of what is happening, usually those situations, people will think you're having the meltdown and you don't know what you're doing. Every teacher I know, and I've gotten pulled into this in the last year, will correct a student at some point, and within a week you'll have an email from a parent of, why did you do that to Johnny? And then we send a loving and hopefully non-sarcastic email back of, well, I did this to Johnny because Johnny did not do his homework, Johnny was disruptive in class, Johnny drop-kicked Sally, and you know, you might want a parent. Can't usually say that last line because that comes off sarcastic, but we're all thinking it. And the parent will either receive it because they now have new information they didn't have, they just had Johnny complaining, or they will still go, well, no, you are just having a bad day and picking on my little precious, whatever they want to call them. Because they don't know everything that's going on. And the more people see you acting in discipline in the name of Christ, which always needs to be tempered in love, the more they're going to think you're just overreacting. Because if we have a culture that doesn't do discipline ever, anybody doing it once, well, you look like the bad guy. I love when some of the best parents I ever know will say, well, there was this one time I had to spank Timmy. And then they will apologize for the next 3 months for that. Because nobody disciplines anymore and they don't want you to think they beat their kid. Whereas the rest of us parents all know is like, I can't believe they said it in public. Should I say it in public? Because I definitely did that probably more than once. We know to discipline, but our culture doesn't allow us to discipline. I've met with parents that sobbed in front of me because they're like, I yelled at my child. I've never yelled at my child before. I was like, what did they do? Just like, they broke this. I was like, good. I was like, They need that loud voice. They need that correction. I will follow it up. Did you do it in anger? Because that's like that weird defining line that you should discipline, but don't do it in anger. Because once you start doing it in anger, you tend to cross lines. But we need to be okay with knowing that not everybody's going to know what's really going on. And you don't have to feel guilty about that. You don't have to apologize for it. You can explain about it if it's appropriate, but you don't have to apologize. If you are acting in accordance with Christ, that you are seeking holiness, that you know you are doing something to become holier and lead somebody in that, you don't have to apologize for that. You can explain, but you don't have to apologize for that. And I'm trying to add as many caveats here so people don't go off the rails and go, "Pastor said I can just beat children." Nope. Did not say that. You do not get to freely go and beat children. Ever. You don't get to just go and tell everybody that you have beef with they're doing stuff wrong. We're not talking about that. We are talking about people who should know better being in relationship with someone who can speak into their lives, who is acting like Christ to give discipline. Like, if we compare it to the situations like this, Elisha had the right because he was the prophet. He was the central voice of God to all of Israel. So whether he knew those boys or not, that's where his right came from. Jesus had the right, whether he knew those temple vendors or not, except he was Jesus, so he did know them, to do that because he had all authority. The rest of us, our authority circle is a lot smaller. And maybe you'll be in a situation where you have no choice but to stand up and speak up because nobody else is. Those do happen. The relationship side can go out the window. You see that type of injustice. The rest of the time, if you don't have the relationship first, what you say will fall on deaf ears. And more likely than not, you'll actually damage the reputation of Christ. This is one of the reasons why we tell you guys time and time again, find a place to serve, because service brings relationship. Because some of you guys actually are in your scripture daily, you're praying daily, and you're great at your relationship with Christ and holiness, but your relationship with everybody else needs work. And honestly, the only way to work on it is to show up. And to every introvert in the room, I have just preached the worst sermon ever now because I told you to show up somewhere. You get to still pick who you show up with. But when you show up, you get that relationship. And then it gives you the place to have the action. And when you're having that action, it doesn't matter what somebody else thinks. Like, unless I do something absolutely horrible, if my kid does something wrong and I discipline him, I'm not going to care what any of you say about it. I don't mean that mean. I just mean you can say it. I'll hear it. I'll probably think about it. But in general, I'm not going to care because you don't go home with them. 9 out of 10 times, we're in public, so they are being perfect angels, so it's probably throwing you off just as much if you witness the 1 out of 10 times they're not being that. And you don't know everything else. And I'm going to pick on AJ because she's not in the room. She was having a complete teenager moment Saturday. She was having to test both Kim and I's levels of holiness on Saturday. Or no, Friday. And if she said one more thing while we were at Sunday school and we decided, okay, this is the moment where you get disciplined, I am sure several people would be like, "Whoa, why did you just go off on her?" Well, because you don't know what happened the rest of the day. This is the same thing. If you are in relationship with somebody and you have the opportunity and motive to give correction and discipline, it doesn't matter what other people say. Yeah, listen. Do receive it. Try and receive it in love, because hopefully they gave it that way. But it's not one of those, hey, we're picking on you. And while he is in the presence of God now, Elisha, kind of feel bad that since this has been written down, pretty much everybody's thought bad of him. It's kind of like doubting Thomas. Everybody picks on the fact that he doubted, and nobody celebrates the fact that he left Israel to India and, you know, led revival there. And about a bunch of you are like, I did not know that. I only learned that this week, actually. But here's the big deal. God always knows what is going on. If you are acting in God's will, in God's presence, in these type of situations, be comforted in the fact he knew what was going on. He knows if you acted right. He knows if you acted in your best intentions. Because sometimes we have the intentions right and maybe the actions wrong, and we get into that grace zone here. But God knows. So if you get into one of these situations where, honestly, I dread the idea of these situations where you do something that's right and everybody disagrees with you, and then you fall into that zone of cancel culture, God knows that you did the right thing. And that is a hope you can hold on to when everybody is just telling the worst things about you ever. This is the weirdest part about cancel culture. It's not like everybody points out a truthful thing about you. You do something that offends them, and they make up every lie in the universe about you and sprinkle in just enough truth that everyone will believe it. This story is not about a person melting down. This is a story that has been recorded in history that everybody else thought they melted down. This is a story about somebody acting in the justice and holiness of God against those who would mock God, of those who would know better. I confuse every parent and teen I've ever had when I've said this one line: I'd rather hear you say a curse word than curse somebody. And everybody that is a good Christian person who goes, what, you would rather them say, and then they will imply some swear word that I'm amazed that they know, because, you know, they're the really good Christian person. Nobody starts that way, and you find out what used to happen. And that you would rather them say that than curse out a person is like, yes. Because when they curse out the person, they are going, I no longer believe they are made in the image of God. I no longer believe that God is calling them to relationship, and they are making them less than human. They are choosing to actually put down God in that moment. They're breaking commandments left and right to say, oh, this person's a slime ball. Actually, I miss the days when they'd call a person a slime ball. It's usually much worse. You guys have gotten creative. Some of them I got to look up because you got your new no cap and all those other phrases that I'm like, you sound like Pauly Shore. No, don't do that. Don't be putting people down in here. Raise people up. Don't be destroying others. Raise them up in the relationship with Christ. And if somebody is getting in the way of someone that is one of those lost sheep of Jesus that he's trying to bring back in, I'm not saying someone bears, but someone bears. It's been a joke in my family for as long as I can remember. My Aunt Rose is the bear in the family. Not because, you know, she's ugly or fuzzy or something. It's because if you got in the way of the family, she's going to go mama bear on you. There is women in this church right now that I know if somebody came in here and said something bad about any kid or teen or well, some of you are the age of anybody up to 40, they are going to go mama bear. I say this jokingly. Ben, if you ever do anything wrong, I'm going to laugh my head off at what Dory's going to do to you. Because we all know there is a mama bear there. We know those scenarios. Those scenarios should be even more applied when it's the kingdom of God and it's somebody that wants to bemoan people coming to Christ, bemoan the church of God. That is when all of us should be willing to let a mama bear come out. Read it that way as an analogy, not as the literal thing that did happen. Because that makes a lot more sense to us now. But there will probably be plenty of you guys that are still like, nope, still don't get this. This really seems horrific. Yeah, it kind of is. There's no way to skirt around. This is a horrific moment. Just like when Jericho had to be taken over and everybody was killed in that kingdom. Yep, it was horrific. Horrific moments happen. But these are moments when we grow in holiness, where we try and see God give us some understanding. Help us to see how your ways aren't our ways, so we can understand what is going on here. Let's pray and worship. I definitely went longer, and some of you guys are getting hungry enough that you might go bear on me now. God, I pray that anytime church discipline comes up, you have us in a place of relationship where we can speak your love and will and even discipline into it. We pray that you are continuously making us holy like you, so that we are disgusted when people who should know better aren't chasing after you, aren't acting the ways that you're calling them to. But in the love of your Son, we would speak into that. Pray this, Jesus, all in your blessed name and by your Holy Spirit. Amen.
Stand and sing.
En el más, más que ayer, en el más, más de lo que pueda decir, en el más. Más que tenerlo, Dios, tenerlo, Dios. I need you more, more than yesterday. I need you more, more than words can say. I need you more than ever. More than the song I sing, more
an everyday mission field.